And so I have the honor of introducing Dr. Ype Elgersma from the Netherlands. And sorry, there's a little feedback. Not sure why. Not sure. Do you? Okay. He is a professor of molecular neuroscience, the chair of research and education in the Department of Clinical Genetics, and the scientific director of the Encore Expertise Center for Neurological or Neurodevelopmental Disorders. That's a very long title. In Erasmus, Rotterdam, in the Netherlands. So, with that, help me welcome Dr. Elgersma.
Good morning, everyone. It's a real pleasure to be here. I joined the AS Angelman research community 25 years ago. And do not worry, I'm not going to try to summarize 25 years of research in just 40 minutes. But I would like to just show some of the highlights, also in particular because most of the work we did along those 25 years was all funded by the ASF. So I will talk about what we do most. We work mostly with animal models. Oh, by the way, I should say that as a disclosure that we have on the Angelman syndrome project, we have currently an active collaboration with both Roche and Neurogene. And actually, we also work with Ionis on different disorders. So as you probably know, neurodevelopmental disorders are typically very rare disorders like Angelman syndrome, 1 in 20,000. But as a group, they are not so rare at all. In fact, we're diagnosing 1% of all children with intellectual disability or neurodevelopmental delay. Now, due to the advances in genetics, and that's one of the reasons I joined the clinical genetics department a few years ago rather than the neuroscience department, due to these advances in genetics, we can now solve up to 70% of all cases identified by identifying the causal gene or mutation. And that leads us now to a staggering of 1,200 genes for which we know that if you have a mutation in that gene, you have one of these rare disorders. So there's more than 1,200 rare disorders like Angelman syndrome. Now, why would someone who has studied neuroscience be interested in these rare disorders? Because I thought that once we know the gene that is causing these defects, we can actually get a very large insight into the biology, like how the brain works and how that mutation changes the brain. But much more so, once we know the gene, I also think that we have a fantastic way forward to actually develop a therapy. And I think what we hear today in the last few days about these antisense therapies is the ultimate dream that I could not imagine 25 years ago. So 15 years ago, we realized that if you're going to do work on rare disorders, we also have to see the patients to understand what it is that we're doing with our mice. But also, once we have findings in our mice that are useful, then we actually can translate them to the clinic. And so that's why 15 years ago, we started the Encore Expertise Center at Erasmus for neurodevelopmental disorders. So what we do is at the Children's Hospital in Sofia, and some of the clinicians are here at the table, there we see the children. They get a diagnosis. We provide the best clinical care, and we give them the best follow-up that is appropriate to the rare disorder that they have. On the other side, we have the lab, our lab, and other labs where we look actually into the functional genomics. So whether some people have variants that we do not really know if they are pathogenic, we can test that, and we also do mouse and cell studies to see what the gene really does in the brain. We can then study molecular mechanisms, as I will just show you in a few slides, understand how that affects brain function. And the ultimate goal is, of course, to develop therapies to improve the quality of life of all these children. And so for all the disorders that we have in the Encore Expertise Center, we also have the mouse models that we study in the lab. The mouse models also serve a very other important purpose. we test many, many drugs in our mouse models, and most of those drugs actually do not work in the mice. And therefore, we're also very grateful that we do not have to test these drugs in the clinic. That would be not only very expensive, but also we would expose the children to drugs that actually do not work. So the mice are also a filter for us to decide which drugs should go into the clinic. Now, I was born just 2 months after Harry Angelman described his first three children that he recognized as being very similar, and which we now know as having Angelman syndrome. And I don't have to tell you, specialists, what the hallmarks are of Angelman syndrome, because you're experiencing them and seeing them every day. Importantly, it took 30 more years to actually understand how Angelman syndrome is caused, and it's always caused by the absence of a maternal UBCA gene, and I will go into that. Now, just some background about, I think you probably, a lot of you will know, but I just want to make sure everyone is on the same track. So some background in genes and proteins. So every cell in our body has chromosomes and has DNA, and that DNA is residing in a nucleus. And I point out the nucleus because I come back to the nucleus in a few minutes. So the chromosomes are in that nucleus, and the chromosomes are nothing else than very tightly bound together DNA. And the DNA is actually our genetic code that we pass on from every cell to every cell. And this code, this genetic code, is large. It has written by 3 billion letters. And since we get this code from the father and the mother, it's 2 times 3 billion letters. And every time a cell divides, it has to copy those 3 billion letters and not make any mistake. But of course, you make mistakes when you copy 3 billion letters. And so that's when mutations start to happen. Now, one of those genes, of course, that is on this DNA, and there are like more than 15,000 genes, one of these genes is the UBCA gene, and that is encoded by 3,000 of such letters, and that makes the encodes the UBCA protein. Now, I want to zoom in a little bit on chromosome 15, because chromosome 15 is very special. It's the locus of the UBCA gene. So as I said, we normally inherit a copy of the father and a copy of the mother. And that is very good, because if there is a writing error in one of these 3 billion base pairs, these 3 billion letters, we always have a backup copy on the other chromosome. Now, chromosome 15 is a little bit different from other chromosomes for two reasons. First of all, it has a number of break pairs. So those are parts in a chromosome where the chromosome can very easily be broken. Now, normally this is not a problem, because once you break the chromosome, there's always the other chromosome from either the father or the mother that you can use as a template to correct the mutation, to correct the break. So often this goes very well. A break is introduced in the chromosome and it's neatly repaired, but sometimes actually the repair is a bit sloppy, and you can have this translocation that you see in this picture, where actually one chromosome gets a deletion and another chromosome gets that point, that part that was deleted, inserted. And so that's an insertion. This is actually no problem at all, because every cell still has the genetic information. It's a little bit different now, divided over the chromosome. One has two copies and the other chromosome has no copy. It becomes very different if that cell is actually destined to be a sperm cell or an egg cell, because then you have to divide the father chromosome and the maternal chromosome over the two cells. And then one cell will have actually a deletion and another cell will have a duplication. And this can also happen immediately after fertilization. Now, if that actually happens, then we actually start to have a problem, because in case of deletion cells, we lack genetic material, and that can cause Angelman syndrome or Prader-Willi, in this case of 15q11 deletions. Or we can actually have a duplication, and then we have dup15q syndrome. Still, it's remarkable that there are so many syndromes associated with the same piece of genetic information. So how can that be? Well, that has to do with something that is extremely unique in nature, and that is that this chromosome 15 has genes that normally they would be expressed from both the father and the mother, so you use both copies to read and to make proteins. But in this instance, you actually have a region in the chromosome for which some of the genes you only use your father's copy, now printed in blue here, and for some of the genes you actually only use the mother's copy, now shown in green here. And as you can see, the UBCA gene is in green, so we only use the copy of the mother. And for other genes, we only use that copy of the father. Now, why is this potentially problematic? It is problematic because now we have only one copy of the UBCA gene that we're using, the copy of the mother. And if that copy is actually getting a mutation, then we have no spare UBCA left. So we know that some of the mutations actually are directly within the UBTA gene. When I started work on Angelman syndrome, this was still a very rare class of mutations, but now the genetics get better and better, and we already know that it's up to 20% of all individuals have this mutation. So this is a growing group, in fact, due to better diagnosis. Now, you can also have a deletion just around those breakpoints, and there are several breakpoints, and so depending a little bit on which breakpoint is broken, but that actually then includes a number of genes, including, again, the UBTA gene. So also here, the UBTA gene is no longer functional. But on top of that, you also lost several other genes. And last but not least, there are two ways that you actually can have two copies of the paternal chromosome that's shown over here. And in that case, we also have no longer UBTA because UBTA is not read from the paternal chromosome. And we have actually a double amount of protein from the genes indicated in blue. And these are the UPD and the impinning center defect mutations. Now, very importantly, and with support from the ASF, we have now mouse models for all four genetic classes of Angelman syndrome. And that is important because so far, basically till last year, everyone only used the UBTA mouse model. So all our scientific work of the last 20 years is all about this UBTA mouse model. And we have really never started to look at what happens if you have the deletion, which is, of course, remarkable because that's, of course, what most patients have. But it just has to do with the technology that we were not able to just delete so many genes at a time, which we can do now. So we have now these mouse models, and what is it that we're going to do? Well, first, I want to point out that the mouse brain, despite its size, I actually took these brains from the clinic and from the lab. You can see immediately there's a big size between a human and a mouse brain. But I want to tell you that if you zoom in on this brain, you see the exact same brain areas. You see a cortex, a hippocampus, a striatum. So basically, the gross anatomy of the brains are very similar. The nice thing about these mice is actually you can look in much very high detail about how these neurons actually then connect to each other. And these beautiful pictures are taken from the so-called brainbow mice. This is a mouse that if you were to isolate the brain and put UV light, this is exactly what you're going to see, a number of thousand different colors neurons. So we can now use these mice to study how these neurons talk to each other and what happens if a gene is lacking, and then what happens to the development of that brain. And finally, I want to point out, and that's what I'm going to show you in the next few slides, that also these mice have a very rich repertoire. They do a lot of stuff that, of course, only mice do, but they also have stuff that very much looks like what we do as human. But I want to point out that although they do their very specific mice behaviors, that they use the same, that they use the specific brain areas that we also see in the human. So I think if I were to say what is our biggest contribution to Angelman syndrome, it's this paper. It wasn't published in a very high-profile journal, and it was extremely boring to do. It took us 3 years to get this data in this paper. But now I can see that all this data is being used in all the laboratories in the world. And so basically what we did is says we want to know how a mouse model with Angelman is different from a control prototypic mouse. And we want to look for tests that are highly that actually for tests that are quick, so you can easily test the drug and it doesn't take you months and months of training an animal. We also want to have tests that have a relation to the clinic, so have a high, we call phase validity, for instance, epilepsy and motor coordination. But last but not least, because I think this is the most important part, a test has to be reproducible because if you test drugs, you really want to know that always your Angelman have a phenotype, show this impairment, and that you really can assess with great reliability your drug. And so what we did is we did really dozens and dozens of tests, but we said only the tests done by eight experiments by five different people, if they all show the same effect on the test, then we consider the test a reliable test for Angelman syndrome drug testing. So we came up with five tests, and I will show you some of these tests that we now use over and over and over again, really many times per year, to test drugs and to study gene mutations. And actually, we can have the tests are so good that we have software that looks at the data, and we're not telling the software whether the mouse has Angelman syndrome or whether the mouse has no Angelman syndrome, but the software is able, with more than 95% reliability, to predict precisely which mice has Angelman syndrome. And in this plot that you see, that on the red bullets are all The dots are Angelman syndrome mice. On the blue are the control mice, and only one mouse was predicted to be an Angelman mouse, but in fact was a wild type mice. And this test does not even include the seizures, because the seizures gives you 100% certainty. Can you start the movie? Thank you. So this is one of the tests that I really like because it has so-called high face validity. We know that children and individuals with Angelman syndrome have problems with the motor function, and the mice have that as well. And so what you see here is what we call accelerating rotor. This machine goes faster and faster and faster until the mice just drop off. And we all have to do is measure the time that the mice was able to stay on the rotor rod. Now, you just saw that a mouse with Angelman syndrome already fell off the rotor rod. But in fact, its right neighbor is the much more interesting mouse, because that mouse has also Angelman syndrome, but was treated with an ASO. Another test that has extremely high face validity, so resembles individuals with Angelman syndrome, is of course an epilepsy test. And the test that we've been introducing in the field is actually a test where we present the mice with a loud noise, 100 decibel, and then we'll see that rarely a wild type mice will actually get a seizure, but 100% of the mice with Angelman syndrome mutations will show a seizure. And the seizure typically lasts like 20 seconds and then we recover from it. And although this is an all or none phenomenon, the mice shows a seizure or does not show a seizure, you can actually use it to titrate drugs. So on the right panel, I showed you how we have an anti-epileptic drug and how we increase the dose and fewer and fewer and fewer of the mice have seizures. So more mice are seizure-free. Now, then I have to admit we have a number of tests and you could really criticize, like, what does it mean? And I'm just showing you a funny one. It's called marble burying test. We put marbles in the cage. And the mice don't like that, and they buried the marbles. Do not ask me why they buried the marbles, but also I can just tell that Angelman mice do not bury the marbles. So also I do not know why Angelman mice do not bury the marbles. But I want you to point out that we start to understand some of the brain circuitry underlying this, and these are the very same circuits that may underlie some of the human behaviors that obviously have nothing to do with marble burying, but it's just that mice use the brain, the same parts of the brain in different ways, and humans use the same parts of the brain. Like ultimately evolutionary resilience, I guess. So some of this is repetitive behaviors and some of this has to do with anxiety. I think the mice don't really like the marbles, but really, I don't know. Also a very mouse specific task, hard to translate to a human clinical trial, is the nest building task. What we do is we take little pieces of paper and we put it in the cage. And after 5 days, we come back and we make pictures of the cage. And you can see on the top are wild type control mice, and we rate the quality of the nests. And you can see they make beautiful nests. They're all rated 3 or 4, and we also weight the nests. And you can also see then, if you look at the lower panel, that we have actually very poor nests. Some of the nests, there's nothing happens. The papers are still just like pieces of paper, precisely as we put them in. And only rare, every now and then, the mice tries to just put them a little bit together and make a nest. So Angelman mice are not able to make a nest or just don't do nest building. I'm going to show you one more test, and that's my last test, that again has no clinical validity, but is extremely useful to us scientists and has been also instrumental for dose finding for ASOs, et cetera. And that is this test, what we call the forced swim test. We put the mouse in a beaker for 5 minutes, and what we just are going to look for is whether the mouse is going to escape from the beaker, so trying to get out. It cannot get out, by the way. Or it will just think, okay, fine, I'm in a beaker. I'm going to just float here for 5 minutes and then someone will probably come up and just pick me up. So that's floating time. So Angelman show this floating time. Most of the time they don't do anything. They're just floating and find it perfectly happy to be in the water. But wild type mice really don't like to float and they try to get out. So in red, you see the Angelman mouse model. And in wild, you see the control mice and their floating time is relative. Now, why do I like this test so much? Because this test is very sensitive to the amount of UBTA that is present in your brain. So if we make one extra copy, or we make two extra copies, or we make four extra copies, we will immediately see that these mice now actually try to even try harder to escape from the beaker. So I don't have to kill a mouse and take out the brain and look at UBTA protein to know how much protein is at any given time in the brain. I just simply put them in the beaker and I can tell by the time they spent floating, how much UBTA there actually was. So extremely helpful for gene therapy programs and antisense oligonucleotide approaches to look how efficient your drug was before you sacrifice the animal. So where has this brought us? Again, I'm showing you the slide of Harry Angelman syndrome with the key hallmarks that he described in his paper. And basically, we can check almost all the boxes. The Angelman mouse have behaviors that very much resemble what we see in the individuals with Angelman syndrome. And although I didn't check the box absence of speech, I can tell you that also we heard that in the scientific symposium 2 days ago, that mice with Angelman syndrome do actually show different complex vocalizations, and that's the way they talk to each other. Now, again, I want to point out that these mice are made by mutating the maternal UBTA gene. As I said, this is what we have been doing for the last 20 years. So just a little back up again into basic genetics, like how did we go from a gene to a protein? So we have the UBTA gene, and that UBTA gene is actually transcribed in a so-called RNA. And that RNA is then translated into a chain of amino acids, which we call a protein. And in case of UBTA, this chain has 852 amino acids in all different tases. There are 20 different tases that you can have. So you make this beautiful chain. And then something magic happens. This chain of amino acids is going to fold spontaneously into something that looks like this. And this is a true picture of how we think and know, basically, that UBTA looks like in a very, structured schematic way. So here you see a picture of the UBTA protein after it has folded itself. And we can really tell by the mutations that are in this protein, which of these domains are very important. Now, what does then the UBTA protein do? Well, we know that UBTA actually is looking for other proteins. And once it finds the so-called target protein, it puts a ubiquitin group on that protein. So that is shown over here. This is a target protein. Actually, this is the protein that got us into the Angelman field 25 years ago, SCAM kinase. So UBTA recognizes a target protein and then puts these ubiquitin groups on there, which we call ubiquitination. And once these ubiquitin groups are on that target protein, this target protein is then going to be recognized by a beautiful protein shredder, which we call a proteasome. So the protein with the ubiquitin is allowed, the lid will open, the protein goes into the in the shredder, and the amino acids are spit out. I should actually have drawn that, but you just have to believe me. Now, what happens if UBTA is not there? If UBTA is not there, the target protein cannot be ubiquitinated, and we get an accumulation of the target protein. So ongoing research in the lab, and this is really something that we've been doing for 20 years, and many, many scientists working on Angelman syndrome have looked for these targets, like what are the critical targets? Which protein that accumulates is so critical to brain function that you do not tolerate that you have too much of that protein? And it's been very hard because there's not a protein that is really like jumping out, like you have now tenfold of this protein accumulating. The best we can see is like some of the proteins are 20 to 30% more present. So we have to understand why that is so toxic to the cell. And hopefully, once we understand that, once we know which proteins are so toxic to the neuron, then we can actually get drugs to target these proteins. So this is an ongoing research question in the lab, and we spent a lot of time already on that in the past, and I'm sure we will do so in the future. Another interesting research line that we have, and this is something that we started more recently, and the PhD student working on this project is actually here in the room, is also that we find that UBTA is also attached to the lid of this protein shredder, this proteasome. And what we're really trying to understand is like, why is UBTA doing that? And I want to point out that there are 600 proteins like UBTA in our neurons, in our cells, and it's only UBTA that is sticking to this lid of this protein shredder, the proteasome. Actually, I forgot to say, but out of the 600 proteins associated UBTA-like proteins, there are more than 70 really causing a neurological disorder. So UBTA is not the only one, but it's the most well-known. Now, why do I bring up this cartoon again from how you go from a DNA to an RNA to a chain of amino acids to a protein? I do that because one of the findings in our lab, and this is something that we also put a lot of time on, is that we actually found that this one gene makes two proteins. So we found that this one gene makes two different messenger RNAs and two different chains of proteins, and therefore also two different UBTA proteins. And what is the difference between these two UBTA proteins? Well, it's very subtle. I don't know if you can see it in my graph, but one protein is just 20 amino acids longer than the other one. So we have a longer protein and we have a shorter protein in our cells. And this we find is really intriguing. Like, why would we make two different proteins? And is one more important than the other? Do we need the shorter? Do we need the longer? Do we need them both? So this is again where mice came in very useful. So we asked ourselves the question, what is the difference between those two proteins? Does it matter if you have 20 more amino acids or not? And second, what happens if you miss the short one? And what happens if you miss the long one? And which would be actually really relevant to study if we think about Angelman syndrome? Well, the first difference, and you don't have to be a cell biologist to see the difference, is that the protein is really in a different place. The short protein, which is shown on your left, the short protein is exclusively in the nucleus. And that's very special because you need a very special VIP card to get into the nucleus. You're not allowed to just go into the center where all the chromosomes are and where all the DNA is. You need to have a very special entry pass to that. And so we really figured out how UBT is able to get such an entry pass and is allowed into the nucleus. The other protein, the long protein, is actually not present in the nucleus at all. You can see it's almost excluded from the nucleus. It's a black hole. So the black hole in the right picture is the nucleus. And UBT is everywhere except in that nucleus. And so now we understand that UBT gene makes two proteins, a longer and a shorter one. The shorter goes in one compartment, the nucleus, and the longer goes to the other compartments. And maybe it has a function in both. Now, our mice were actually quite clear about that. And they said, it's actually, we don't know really what the function is of the protein that is not in the nucleus, but the protein in the nucleus is really the one we should probably focus on first. Because if you have mice that have just the protein in the nucleus, those mice are perfectly fine. But if you have mice that lack the protein in the nucleus, those mice show all the symptoms of our Angelman syndrome mouse models. So we now know that we really have to focus a lot of attention on, if you want to understand what UBT is doing, on the protein that is actually residing in the nucleus. And so a lot of our lab now focuses on the role of UBT in the nucleus. How did it get in there and what is it really doing there? Now, how does that directly translate to clinical relevance? Well, it has been extremely helpful to us to understand a lot of variants that we find in the UBTA gene. So when we sequence the UBTA gene in individuals with potentially Angelman syndrome, we find something that are very subtle changes. So one of those balls, one of those amino acids, just changed color. Is that pathogenic or not? Typically, we don't know the answer. So what we do now is actually, whenever we find a variant that we call, for which we do not know if it's actually pathogenic, we take that gene, put it in a mouse neuron, and then see whether the UBTA protein is able to go to the nucleus or whether it's not able to go to the nucleus. And in more than 50%, it's almost 60% of all the variants that we see in individuals with UBTA mutations, we find that no longer can the protein go to the nucleus. Again, suggesting, of course, that the nucleus is actually very important. But this is also very helpful for us to say, this person has definitely Angelman syndrome because UBTA is actually affected and cannot do its normal job, as opposed to other variants that we see where we say, well, this variant has normal protein activity. It's normally located in the nucleus. Therefore, we think that this variant is benign and not causing the symptoms that you're looking at. Now, last few slides, I want to talk a little bit about our treatment for Angelman syndrome. Actually, I really don't know anymore how much time I have because I started later. I'm okay. Okay, good. So I want to talk about treatments. And basically, we have three kinds of treatments. The past, I would say, 15 years, I just focused on drugs that improve overall neuronal function. Can we find drugs that improve the epilepsy? Can you find something that changes the behavior, that the mice walk better? We call them like the small molecules. This is still an ongoing effort in the lab, and I think every year we test at least one or two or three drugs like that. Second, you could think, okay, once we know the targets, then we can actually find drugs that modulate these targets, those target proteins that accumulate in a neuron, in an AS neuron, and then see actually if we can target those proteins that accumulate. The problem with this approach is we simply do not yet know which one are the critical targets that cause Angelman syndrome. So for now, we just have to abandon this until we know more about the biology. Now, the last approach, and this is really the approach I'm so excited about, is drugs that restore UBTA protein. And I'm in fact so excited about this approach that after 20 years, I left the Department of Neuroscience and knocked on the door of the Department of Clinical Genetics. And then I became head of research at the Department of Clinical Genetics. Because I think ultimately, probably the best way to treat Angelman syndrome is actually to give back the gene, the protein that the patients really lack to start with. Now, there's several ways we can actually do it. And you may have read things in newspapers. And I just want to go very quickly through it. But I know there's other sessions where this is going to be covered again. So first of all, we have this fantastic CRISPR-Cas technology that rendered the Nobel Prize, for which we allow to very precisely manipulate the DNA and make it any way that we want. And in fact, this is the way that we now made the large deletion mice, et cetera, et cetera. So we use this technology in our lab actually to make mutations rather than to solve the mutations. Now, the advantage, if you had a technology like that, it would be a single treatment because you just repair the DNA and that's it. But there's also disadvantages. Right now, this technology is not good. If I use it to make a mouse, a lot of my mice are not good. They just have errors. And so it's still very much error prone. You don't want to have a mistake in another gene while you're repairing one gene. Now, also, although this technique is used, for instance, to isolate bone marrow, to manipulate the bone marrow, and then to put back the cells that were corrected, you cannot take out the brain, manipulate all neurons, and just put back the brain. I'm very sorry that got you awake. So last but not least, so as I said, also in vivo manipulation is not really possible. You cannot go in with the virus and repair exactly the kind of DNA that you want at this time. I mean, the technology goes really fast. This might be different in a few years from now. And also want to point out, if you have a large deletion, there's nothing to repair because if the gene is gone, you can't repair it. So for now, I would say just forget about this technology, but maybe we'll hear more about this in 5 years from now. Now, a technology that I'm much more excited about and that we actually already testing in the lab, and many, many scientists are working on this kind of technology, is use a virus to introduce a protein. And that could be either a protein that activates the gene of the father, or it's you actually introduce a virus that carries the UBTA protein itself and makes UBTA protein. The nice thing about viral approaches, it will be, again, a single treatment. But on the other hand, it will be really hard to control the level of virus and therefore also the level of UBTA. And too much UBTA might not be good. Also, right now, our technology does not allow to target all the neurons in a human brain. And therefore, it would require multiple injections into a brain. So for now, this technology is not yet good enough, but it's actually already pioneered. And there are, in fact, already clinical trials where we use virus-based approaches to introduce genes. So this is something that is really coming up, in the next few years. But what I'm really excited about, and we just heard from the CEO of Ionis, is this antisense oligonucleotide approach. Spinal muscular atrophy, the Spinraza drug, really changed the field and really showed also that neurons really like to take up this drug. So how does this drug work? Very schematically, basically what the whole point is of this drug is that we want to activate that copy of the father's gene, the UBTA copy, that was not active because it was silenced. And in fact, it's silenced by a so-called antisense RNA, which we call an inhibitory RNA that protects the UBTA from being transcribed. So these are my slides that I used early on to go to parent meetings that I say, okay, imagine that you have two copies of the genes of your chromosome, one from the mother and one from the father. And in this case of UBTA, you know, you have normal expression of the mother's allele, but not of the copy that you got from the father. Now, the ideal drug, so in case of Angelman syndrome, you have, you know, the gene of the mother is mutated or are lacking altogether if you're deletion, so you cannot use that gene. Now, the optimal treatment would actually be to now regulate the traffic light of the bottom part, because then you can say, okay, if I were to allow that traffic light to go to green, then I can actually use the father's copy, and I don't really care that the mother's copy is either deleted or mutated. So a magic drug would work like this, that actually changed the traffic light, and the light jumps to green, and the protein can now be made from the father's allele. And this magic drug we now actually have at hand. It's called this antisense oligonucleotide ASO. So this is, I think, a game changer. And really, it was work from Art Baudet and many other people funded by ASF that made this, that first of all, understood how this gene, UBTA gene, is regulated and silenced. And then secondly, moved forward to see how that can actually be used as a treatment. So basically, I say we have a spare copy of the UBTA gene. It's just that we can't use it. But now we have a drug to unlock this gene and actually start using it. So what do we do in our lab to look at, first of all, let me go to the advantages and disadvantages. First of all, ASOs have an amazing brain distribution. I'll show you a picture of that. UBTA overdosing is in principle not an issue. It could be an issue if you have UPD or ICD, but I'll tell you it's not. The nice thing, it should work for all Angelman syndrome patients. It doesn't matter if you have a deletion or a mutation because all of us have that spare copy of the father and that is unaffected. Disadvantages, actually, it requires multiple intrathecal or ICV injections. But of course, it's already, some of these drugs are already clinical approved. And I think this is definitely a technology that is going to move forward. And everyone really looks at Angelman syndrome because that's, I think, where the most exciting things will probably happen, hopefully happen. So what is it that we do in a lab? We ask very basic questions like, okay, great that we have an ASO, but how much ASO do we need to inject? Or really actually the question is, how much UBTA protein do we need? If you have 10% of UBTA protein, is that sufficient to just rescue Angelman syndrome? Or do we need 95% of UBTA protein? Because if that latter is the case, then we are in trouble because an ASO is good, but not that good. Also, how often should we give an ASO? And should we actually give it lifelong, or could we just give it while the children grow up? And then when they are adult, maybe we don't really need it anymore because the brain is already normally developed. And so it can just do without UBTA. In mice, it actually suggests that once you have normal development of the brain, you can actually quite well do without the UBTA gene. So of course, then the question is also, what time should we actually really start these treatments? Everyone can understand that early it must be better, but like how early do we have to understand to treat? And if you're going to do this in a clinical trial, then what is it that you're going to look for? Are you going to look for epilepsy? Are you going to look for motor coordination? All of it, behavior. So these are the questions that we can start to address. And also, I think most importantly, does this ASO technology really work safely for all four genetic classes of Angelman syndrome? So mice can really tell us the answers about these questions. So I will briefly go over this, and then these are my last slides. So first, distribution. The distribution and efficacy of an ASO is tremendous. Here you can see on the left side a mouse brain, a cortex and a hippocampus. And you see a little bit of green, and that is indicating the UBTA protein, but that is from the blood vessels where we actually are able to use both the gene of the father and the mother. Now you see that the neurons are blue, which means they are empty. But if you give an ASO, you can see immediately the brain starts to lighten up green, meaning that all this UBTA is now actually made. And we can quantify that. And in mice, we can almost get to 100% UBTA levels. But these are direct brain injections. I don't think that right now we would be able to achieve that in humans. So neurons take up these ASOs and we have an amazing brain distribution. Okay, the second question, really, how much protein do we need? And so we looked at one test because it's so easy. It's this test where we present them with a loud noise and then the mouse will just show a seizure, yes or no. So that's a very simple test. And so what we did is we took mice and we injected increasing doses of ASO and then looked when the mice are epilepsy free. Our actual experiment here is shown in the other way around. We actually went from our best working dose and we started to decrease and decrease the dose further and further. So the protein levels go almost down linearly if you use the ASO. But you see then the audiogenic seizures start to go up. So the red means you have not given any ASO, so all the mice show seizures. And the first blue bar is you have 50% of ASO and then 25% of ASO. So the good news is, so we don't apparently need 100% of UBTA. In particular, well, at least for this test, it suggests that 30% of UBTA protein is perfectly doing the job. And that's where the number that we should go after if you want to have a functional drug. But this could be, of course, different for different brain regions, and it could be different for different behaviors. So we have to test that. So which behaviors can you actually rescue when you give an ASO? Well, I can tell you can rescue many of the behaviors, but not all of the behaviors. So like this marble test, burying test, and a nest building test that I just showed you in the beginning, those tests cannot be rescued if you give an ASO. Some other tests, we see a very significant improvement, like this rotor rod test. And also if you look at synaptic plasticity, it's just that they're not as good as wild type yet, but very significantly improved. And then there are also tests like the force swim test, the open field test, and the seizure resistance test, where we can really no longer, the software can no longer tell apart a wild type mouse from an Angelman mouse because In every aspect, this mouse behaves as good as a wild-type mouse, so we have 100% rescue of that phenotype. So how can it be that we can treat some of these phenotypes so well and some of these phenotypes cannot be treated? Well, I think this has to do exactly with the brain development and the critical period. And I think it really depends on what outcome measure you're looking is whether what the critical period is. And I'll explain it in this graph. So what this graph is actually showing is that our brain develops in different stages. First, and all these stages have an effect on how the brain actually is able to work. And the first stage is already happening in the womb and before birth or around birth is actually that we have innate behaviors. Like a baby will just, when you put something in the mouth, it will just swallow. So that's an innate behavior. You don't have to train the baby to do that. Then second, we have these sensory behaviors. The children start to look at things, follow with their eyes, they listen. And that this is the period that happens in many, many years after birth and gets fully shaped. We know it's a critical period that at one point will stop because if you have a lazy eye, so one of your eyes does not work well, that we know that you have to patch the eye that really works well. And so you can actually help the function of that lazy eye. But that patch is no longer working after 8 years of age, because then you can no longer switch the brain to actually look with both eyes. So binocular vision actually has a critical period. And then, of course, there's a long period where we can learn languages. Most of you can still learn languages, even in adults, but it will be in a different brain area than the original, your native language. And finally, of course, there are higher cognitive functions, and they can last for a lifetime. We learn every day. You learn while you're sitting in this meeting. So now knowing that the brain develops in these stages, it's not so surprising that this very innate behavior of nest building or not liking marbles is actually an innate behavior that is built into the mouse. And we cannot rescue it once the mouse is born because this is how it was just programmed, the brain. It's not doing this consciously. Epilepsy is something that we can see that in the mice, like up until adolescence, we can fully rescue the epilepsy and then it becomes a little bit more harder. And that has to do because we use audiogenic seizures. So as a loud noise, so there's sensory input. So that can all be rescued in the first 4 weeks of the mouse life. Motor coordination, we can actually see we have a much longer window. Like mice are almost adults when we can still see improvements in the rotor rods, typically around until 6 weeks in mice. And then we find that if you look at synaptic plasticity, it really doesn't matter anymore what age you treat because we can basically always restore synaptic plasticity. So the message is, of course, younger treatment will be better. But I think that in the end, everyone can benefit from ASO therapy, even at older ages. But the expectations must be not as good as the ones that are treated very young. That's what the mice suggest. And last but not least, the point I want to make is that in new studies that we showed at the meeting and at the last meeting, they're all unpublished, is that we actually showed that it doesn't matter what class of genetic mutation you have. So all four classes of genetic mutations can be treated with an ASO. And we actually think that there's very good evidence now in mice that we actually should include all children in the trial and that no children should be excluded. Now, finally, I looked at all the people that worked in the lab that did a PhD on Angelman syndrome, and it's been quite a list. These are the people that did that. I want to point out two people. Ben Distel used to be my supervisor, but then he stopped his lab at some point and moved to Erasmus MC, and now he's retired, but he still works on Angelman syndrome, and we share the office, and I think this is just fantastic, but it shows his dedication to Angelman syndrome. And I also really want to thank Edmintius has been in the lab for a long time, for more than 10 years, and he has been instrumental for making all the mouse models that I was just talking about. Now, I also really am very grateful to the Ben Philpott lab. I think Matt Judson might still be here. We have a fantastic collaboration. That means that we very frequently just call each other. We talk about unpublished data. We share the reagents. We share mice across the ocean, which has been really hard during Corona times. I can tell you that for one of the mouse lines, it took 2 years to finally get it across. A few times all the ice was frozen because we actually ship sperm. We're not allowed anymore to ship mice. The sperm got at Erasmus MC and it was the ice was all gone and melted and we had to do the whole procedure again. But finally, we found a very smart way to get reagents across, including mice. And last but not least, really, I would say that 80% of the work that we're doing is probably funded or was started by funding from the ASF. And so I'm extremely grateful for the ASF. And that basically means to all of you, for funding our lab for these last 20, 25 years. Thank you. Yeah, it's whatever you want.
I think we have time really quickly for one or two questions if you want to make your way to the mic. Anyone? Otherwise, I think Ipe will be around and happy to answer
Right, and there will
questions
be a Q&A, so I will be at the
later. Right.
late. Yeah.
Okay. Thank you so much. It's truly amazing. 20 years ago, when the ASF funded the first mouse model, and now we have four for all the various types, it's remarkable. And thank you to your lab and everyone who continues to make progress in that area.